Hello there again. I'm Pastor Michelle Allen here at First Presbyterian Church in Williamstown, New Jersey, and we all welcome you to our YouTube channel and that you may receive a blessing today as we continue our trek through the Bible and as we talk about the books of the Bible and why they're grouped the way they are. Much of the grouping of the books of the Bible, much of the choices about what would be in the Bible and what would not be in the Bible, were done in the early centuries following Jesus' death. And it was quite a process. The church took time and much prayer in talking about which books would go where and why they were placed the way where they are. Even in today's world, we hear about books that, you know, didn't make it into the Bible, or these biblical books that are, or I shouldn't say biblical books, but extra-biblical books that pop up, you know, very interesting tales about them. They're real, apparently, but they are not consistent with the witness to Jesus Christ and to the Lord, our God, and that's why many of them are not in the Bible. But remember, these were painstakingly difficult choices that the church took years to make. So it was not done lightly, and it was not done quickly by any means. Today we find ourselves in another grouping of books of the Bible, and I want to read for you a passage from the first one. It's called 1 Timothy, and anytime you hear a first, you know there's got to be at least a second. So in this one, it says this at the very beginning. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the command of God our Savior, and of Christ Jesus our hope. So, again, who's writing this? Paul. But it's not known as a Pauline epistle as much as it is, and I'll get to that in a minute. He says, to Timothy, my true son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. This is a little different than the Pauline epistles that we looked at yesterday. This is called a pastoral epistle. Like a pastor, like myself, it's that tone in these books, or in these letters, that Paul is believed to have authored, because they are named for particular people. So where you had 1st and 2nd Corinthians that was addressed to a church, now you have more individualized letters that are included in the New Testament. And that's because Paul, coming with being an evangelist, also took time to train the leaders in the churches. And I will tell you, some of the most important work you do as a pastor, if you have pastors out there listening, is the time you take to train leaders in the churches. Because guess what? The churches should be around a lot longer than the pastors are. So the most important work you do as a pastor, and I'm known as a teaching elder, because my main job is to teach people about Jesus and to train leaders in the churches. Because without leaders in the churches, what direction are you given? Where do you go as a church? So in our tradition, it's the elders. And if you've ever served out an elder session in a Presbyterian church, you know that as much as you train, there's still going to be stuff that comes up that's unexpected. And you want to have the best guidance you can in your back pocket so that you know how to lead your church. So Paul was a friend of these pastors and leaders in the churches, and Timothy is one of them. And it's wonderful to read about Timothy because it talks about how his mother and his grandmother were believers. So Timothy, and he wrote two letters to Timothy, apparently. And then there's Titus, who is also another church leader. And then Philemon. Now, Philemon is interesting because Philemon, when you get to that book, let me get there in a minute with you. If you look at the book, and these are not very long books by any means. These are rather short books of the Bible, so they're easy to get through. And you will read about Timothy and Titus in the book of Acts. That's why I keep reminding you that is a very important book to have read before you get to all these letters or epistles. But when you get to, if I can get there, when you get to the book of Philemon, which is really in some Bibles it's maybe a page, maybe 2 pages tops. You find an interesting story, and you gather the story and the circumstances from reading the letter. He writes it to Philemon, who is, he calls him a friend and fellow worker. And he also addresses other things. But he's talking to Philemon, who owns another human being. And the other human being is Onesimus. And he mentions him in the letter. And he says, listen, let Onesimus go. Free him. And he goes on and on about that. But one thing is, Paul is talking to this Christian leader and trying to help him become a better Christian. And so that letter is very interesting because it talks about the particulars of one of the leaders of the church. Now, he does that with Timothy. He does it with Titus. He gets very particular, very detailed in his letters to these gentlemen because he is trying to guide them. Because remember, when you're a leader, you are often seen as an example as well. So he's trying to guide them very, very strictly on course so that they can be good leaders in the churches where they serve. So these are interesting letters to have. Again, you have insights here that from being a pastor and a trainer or a teacher in the early church, and it gives us great insight into what it means to be a leader in the church. So they're very pastoral. They're meant to be teaching and guiding these men as they lead their churches or their ministries. So wonderful insights to have, and again, wonderful words to learn and to teach. So if you're a leader in some way, and it doesn't mean you have to be on the board at your church or on the session at your church, you might just be leading in a ministry, or, you know, you might be a leader in your family. Great things to gain from God's word in these letters. So let's pray on that. Lord, we give you thanks for these words in your scripture that give us a little more personal taste of what it means to minister in your name. We thank you for the teachings here in these books and for the wonderful expressions and insights and really general ideas of how to live the Christian life as a leader in the church. And we are grateful for the ways in which you teach us, even now, through your Holy Spirit, as we read these books and gain wisdom and insight and understanding. May you always bless the leaders in your churches, for they are your chosen ones, and you equip them to do amazing things. Help them to always have faith in you, and to remember that we all serve an amazing God who is ready to do amazing things through his people. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for your church and for all of your people. In Jesus' name, amen. And may God bless you as you continue to read through the Bible and as you gain and glean more insight and wisdom and understanding about the grace of God made known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. God bless you.